Hey, what's up guys? Phoenix here, and this video is going to be the Yugioh Pro Duel video, another competitively oriented set of gameplay matches, this time against Sky Strikers, the basically proven best deck of the format at this point. Whether or not anything from Soul Fusion will be able to come and sort of disrupt that title that it has of best deck of the format has yet to really be like theorized or seen. YCS Niagara Falls is definitely going to be a very interesting place. I'm definitely going to be looking at the results of that event very intently to try and find out, you know, as much information as we can get as to how, like, the format's going to progress itself towards Pasadena. But basically, what I'm going to be playing is this Fluffal list. I've made some tweaks from the previous video. I'm playing Edge Imp Cotton Eater, although it usually almost always gets sided out. It is a cool thing to grab off of Patchwork to get you a draw, which means that you're... It's basically just a worse upstart goblin, but it is still an Edge Imp monster, which can be used for fusing if you need to, or you can just scale it and get the draw so it does replace itself if you don't need it, so that's kind of neat. I'm playing Frightful Factory because everyone keeps telling me I need to play this card, although I basically sided out every game that I play usually, because I just don't see myself needing this card. Every time I have a chance to search it, I either search for Fright for Fusion, or like I don't need the factory, so I just search for a Patchwork for a possible follow-up turn or something like that. Every time I'm searching for a Fright for card, I'm always grabbing either Patchwork or Fright for Fusion. I never see the need for this card, especially with cards like Fusion Recovery in my list as well. Like, this card is great. This card is fantastic. But other than that, I see people recommending Fluffal Sheep to me, and I've had just as many people tell me not to play that card, so I haven't seen people realistically play that card post Master Rule 3. I understand you can make Mrs. Radiant off Dog with it, but are you really trying to just go Dog Search Sheep into just Mrs. Radiant? I don't think that's very economical. And I've also had people tell me not to play Brilliant Fusion, which I think is absolutely asinine. If you open Dog or Bear plus Brilliant Fusion, that is just literally a casual, like, plus 5. You have the Brilliant Fusion and the Seraphine on the field, which gives you 2 normal summons, which is insane. You get a Toy Vendor, which you could get lucky off of. But then you just get to draw 2 cards and search a card that is going to be something you normal summon off of the Seraph Knight being there. And then it's also just another outlet into Mrs. Radiant because this is an Earth monster. So you get 2 normal summons and you get to go into this. So, like, I don't see why people would tell me not to run this card other than the fact that they just don't understand how good it is at being a good starter card. And, like, you never really brick on the Garnet if you have access to Edge Imp Sabers and a fusion play, because you just like fuse with the Edge Imp Sabers or just like summon it and link away with it or whatever, and then put the Garnet on top of your deck to summon the Sabers from your grave and then play the Brilliant Fusion. So like, there's a lot of different ways for you to mess around, or even like Toy Vendor discarding the Sabers. It's very easy for you to get access to your Garnet back into the deck if you drew it. So very interesting to note, but this deck is very weird to me. As you can see, my side deck is a lot of cards that like I want to side in, and against Strikers, I would side in like Kaijus, Hatrunades, stuff like that. I found myself only siding in 2 Kaijus out of this 4 Kaiju package because like I can't find enough cards to take out of my deck to put those cards in. I'd swap out the Called by the Graves for the Hatrunades, obviously, but then like for the Kaijus, I take out the Cotton Eater and the Fright for Factory usually for 2 Kaijus, and the most things I could do from beyond that is like take out Monster Reborn for a 3rd Kaiju, but I think that's kind of overkill at that point. But that's one of the things that I found like the hardest about this deck, is that siding is super weird because you never really want to be siding out your like key engine cards. So like past Cotton Eater and Factory, which aren't really starter engine cards or really that good of extenders, I really don't want to take anything else out as it stands, but maybe I will figure out a bit more information on how to pilot this deck a bit more as time goes on. But other than that, been rambling long enough in this part of the video. Let's just jump straight into the gameplay against Sky Strikers, and you can see how the matchup played out for yourselves. Alright, so first game, I'm going to be going second every single game of this match. It's one of those things where my opponent, even in the chances that they have that they could choose to make me go first, they actually just don't, because Sky Striker as a deck is not going to be a deck that goes second and OTKs you in most situations. So it's not really worth it for him to tell me to go first just for me to do something like summon a dog and get a simple search and then pass, and then he can't kill me. And then I get to kill him, even though he's like set up resources. There's some argument to be made of letting like Fluffal go first, even if you're playing Sky Striker, but my opponent currently does not feel like that is the correct play. So all of these games I'm going to be going second. But this is game 1 of match 1. My opponent has sort of a weird start. It's not really that great. It still ends with double Widow Anchor set, but Shizuku in the end phase for engage is pretty much like not really that impactful. He could have easily played the Widow Anchor. He could have searched Widow Anchor, played it on Shizuku, and then set it with multi-roll to have three Widow Anchor set. But the main thing I'm worried about in this matchup isn't even really Widow Anchors. Widow Anchor is definitely a big problem to play through with this deck, playing through in multiples, if your opponent is stealing your monsters. But if your opponent's not stealing your monsters because he doesn't have three spells in grave, Widow Anchor definitely matters a lot less. But as you can see, I'm not capable of killing my opponent. I get him down to 300. He starts using all of his resources to take my stuff and try to clear my board as much as possible, taking my Sabertooth, making Nightmare Phoenix, popping my Cotton Eater from my scale. And I have very few cards, but clutch top deck of a Foolish Burial Goods to send Toy Vendor to get my stuff going, and now I just have to do something to get my opponent to lose 300 life, and that should be very easy for me to do, especially since I know where all of his set Widow Anchors and stuff are from his multi-roll. I know what all of his sets are and in what locations they're in, so it's very easy for me to just Twin Twister the right cards. So I didn't really think I was going to be able to come back and win that game after my OTK got stopped by Widow Anchor removing the attack boost, but I mean, it ended up working out in my favor. But so, next game, my opponent starts, has a very decent opening hand of multi-roll Area Zero and some engages. In fact, all three of them, I think you'll find. So, not going to be getting too many bonus cards off these engages, but the last engage will draw an extra card, and there's an Eagle Booster with some set Widow Anchors. Now, see, my opponent doesn't even know that much about the interaction of that I was talking about in my video yesterday on how Eagle Booster with three spells in grave is really hard for Fluffals to deal with. Every time my opponent sets that up, he does it like subconsciously. He doesn't really actively do it. So my opponent's not really playing in respect towards Fluffals. He's just playing in respect towards an OTK deck. And so it's one of those things where I could have been gotten in a lot of situations where he had a way to set up Eagle Booster with three spells in grave. There's a few instances where that could have been a lot more impactful in the games, or when he did set it up, just like out of nowhere, like not really consciously doing it, just doing it because he could, and didn't feel like extra Widow Anchors were needed. I'd have like a Kaiju for him anyway, so it's like, wasn't even that big of a deal. But so here you see I top deck a Hatrunade, play it into his back row. He chains Call by the Grave on my dog, and the card I reveal off my Toy Vendor when I use its effect is Fluffal Dog, so its effect is getting. I'm like, great, fantastic. But then he ogres my Owl because I have so few cards. I'm playing a Fusion deck, obviously. So it's one of those things of if I have the Owl not on my field, that's one less card I can fuse with, and I don't have enough cards to fuse with the one card in my hand plus Poly. So it was a very smart decision. But so my opponent's doing a lot of really nice plays of Shark Cannon, Chain Widow Anchor to take my monster, and Special Summon a monster off Shark Cannon to make big, like, life point push swings with making Nightmare Phoenix down in the main monster zone, making a Kagari or some Sky Striker like next to it, and then summoning Ray. That way Ray can tag out into the extra monster zone that's now vacated. So that's a play that you'll see him do a lot. It's one of those things that's like, it's like the next best thing to do outside of Boral Sword. But so my opponent doesn't really open that amazing. I mean, it's an engage. It's an engage multi-roll into Area Zero with a Shizuku, using Widow Anchor on the Shizuku then to then reset it. But so I know there's at least a Widow Anchor set. I know that there should be another one set, and I'm just able to just Kaiju him. Kaijus are really like the biggest benefit that you like the biggest benefactor you have in this matchup. In fact, I almost kind of want to just side the Kaijus and not even side card like Hatrunade, because Hatrunade, like, they can chain to that. Like, you saw like the previous game where Call by the Grave on my dog really, really messed up my entire turn sequence. Whereas if I had a Kaiju, the Call by the Grave still would have been a problem, but like other back row, like Eagle Booster or Widow Anchor or Shark Cannon or whatever, can't be chained to that. So I might just play more of the Kaijus and just not even play the Hatrunades, even though I think Hatrunade is pretty good in this matchup. But so, as you can see, making some plays, forcing through an OTK with a Wolf with four materials on it, going through a shared ride, playing through a shared ride, just the Kaiju started this turn structure that just was really insane, because I turned off all of his back rows, his Widow Anchors that I knew were there. I had Twin Twister that I could utilize. I could use the Fright for Tiger to just clear the rest of the things and just go for it. That was a lot of damage on board. But so going into next game, my opponent just keeps opening with the the goo play, the engage area zero multi role play, and it's just like, man, can you just like not please? But so ends up with a set strike, with a set shark cannon and a widow anchor and cards coming back off multi role, and so I start my play with normal summon dog and he just throws the widow anchor at it because he'd get it back for free in the end phase anyway with multi role, and he has the strike set, so he's not too worried about anything else. He also has the shark cannon set. So he's not worried about a Fluffal Wing play to gather a lot of resources. So it was just one of those things that he just decided to negate the first card that he saw, and it just ended up being that it just completely made my hand completely dead. But so what you see here is now he's going for a Boral Sword play because he has the normal summon of Ray left, and so he turns Ray to defense mode, then makes it into a Kagari, and this is exactly 8,000 because Borload attacks twice now, and Kagari is at 2,000 because there's five spells in Grave. So just being able to push through and kill me after he's had a turn to set up is definitely one of Sky Striker's big strengths. It can't really tell Fluffles to go first and then kill it when you're going second with no setup, but if you've had a turn, then you're capable of usually just killing your opponent on turn three with Sky Strikers if you're playing in some sort of correct manner. But so my opponent's able to Eagle Booster on Shizuku here, but he does not have three spells engraved, so it's actually a lot easier for me to deal with. But so I hate Trunade him. He plays his Hornet Drone, and things are just, you know, good for me because I don't have to deal with hand traps, right? The Widow Anchor's back in his hand. There's a Hornet Drone that I have to get off the field, a Hornet Drone token, but, like, that's easy enough with Kraken, which I'm going to fuse away with anyway. Fusion Recovery coming in hot to just add back the dog for a possible follow-up play, but as you can see, I just am able to kill him. Absolutely end this man's existence. His dueling career is over. Attack over the Shizuku, attack again into the Ray with the Kraken, and then one Kraken and the Sabertooth just haven't attacked yet, and that's 8k by itself. So, fantastic way of a turn structure. You can definitely get lucky with Fluffles against Sky Strikers. It's definitely one of those things where it's a get lucky, get good deck. And if your opponent is not actively in the mindset of playing around Fluffles in like the specific capacity of what has to happen there, then it can be very easy for you to steal games. It's definitely one of those decks where I don't think this matchup is unwinnable by any stretch of the imagination. Game 1 is definitely rough, but Game 2 and 3, when you have like Kaijus in your deck, hey, Trunades in your deck, things that are just like one card bombs against their entire back row, and then you're able to pick them apart and chain block for strike and stuff like that, then usually you do have a pretty easy time of forcing game through, specifically because their boards aren't that big. Their boards are literally just usually one Link monster consisting of either a Kagari or a Shizuku, and then you just have to play through the Ray that comes back or just not even care about it if it's something that you don't need to worry about. But so, as you can see from here, this game did not work out that well for me. I opened with a Kaiju, which was great, but really needed the Brilliant Fusion to resolve, but it got Ash Blossomed, and then my Fluffal Wing either got called by the Grave or Shark Cannoned. Can't remember exactly what happened, but it just got taken out of the Grave before I could use my Toy Vendor on it, and then my Toy Vendor got dealt with by, I think, getting shuffled back into the deck off Unicorn, and he's able to set all his cards off multi-roll. I'm drawing to one card, and it's just a Kaiju, which I just give him, and he's like, I can out this with multi-roll, it's easy. So, not really anything I could do there. But so, going into the next game, my opponent did not open well. He opened with multiple shared rides, or one shared ride and drew into another, but opened with a Widow Anchor, but no monsters. It's very interesting. Like, his deck is built to be as like consistent as possible. Like, he's playing Desires, he's playing Upstart, he's playing like all of like the Sky Striker cards that like start your engine going at 3, but for some reason he's just getting unlucky with RNG in a couple of these games of just not drawing into one of like literally your one card starters, like whether it's Area Zero or Ray or Rhoda or Desires or Engage or whatever. Very interesting. But so, as you saw, I was able to just put the Edge Imp chain on the field. I Monster Reborn the Edge Imp chain just to play some simple Yu-Gi-Oh! Leaving it on the field until the next turn. It was going to leave the field and it was going to get another search, so I was just going to put some damage down and not really play too further into the shared ride because I kind of assessed that my opponent's hand was really weak. But now Widow Anchor taking my Tiger. I was trying to use Tiger to pop his one set, which was the Widow Anchor and my Toy Vendor, to get a search, but unfortunately wasn't able to do that, but still capable of going into a Boral Sword play and just attacking over the Tiger that he took for game. And that's what I was talking about earlier, is that when your opponent's taking your fusions with Widow Anchor, that's when it hurts the most. if your opponent's not taking them with Widowmaker, then it really isn't really that big of an issue because you can just fuse away with the cards. It's not like you lost anything. You lost whatever effect you were trying to utilize, but basically nothing else really matters other than the fact that you don't have that fusion monster anymore to fuse into like Sabertooth and step up. But so, my opponent goes first, opens an okay hand, opens Shared Ride, gets a Widowmaker and stuff down with a Shizuku. I just play the Gamma Seal straight on top. The Kaijus make this matchup actually a lot easier than it seems to be. Like, this matchup, like, judging from the games that I played, and then the warm-up games that we played before I started actually saving replays, to at least, like, figure out, like, how we were going to, like, approach the stuff. Because every time I play for these videos, I always let my friend, like, we play some games first, just to, like, get ourselves warmed up, to make sure we're making, you know, at least proper plays and stuff like that. And then from there, we start actually saving the replays. And I tell them, I was like, all right, we're starting now. Even in the practice games, every game that I just opened a Kaiju against his back row was just an absolute blowout. Because, like I said earlier, even when he had Eagle Booster down, when I was just able to Kaiju over him, even with Eagle Booster being alive for three spells, it was just insane. So I'm not even sure if I would continue citing Heytrunade because of the fact that, like, I do want more space to put in the rest of the Kaiju package, which I talked about earlier in this video, that I really don't see a lot of room of cards I could take out without interfering with the deck's engine and making the deck less consistent as a whole, rather than, like, unless I just take out the Heytrunades and put in, like, the more Kaijus, that's the only swap I could think of. And against a Kaiju, they can't shotgun the Eagle Booster, which I thought was going to be a huge problem in this matchup. But every time he set up Eagle Booster, I had a Kaiju, so it, like, didn't matter nearly as much as I made a point to think that it was in the videos that I talked about Eagle Booster being a problem. But so, it was really weird. I don't know how to take the result of this one. I definitely want to test more against different variations of Sky Strikers that, you know, have more traps in them, have things like Infinite Impermanence in them, stuff like that. But anyway, that is all for this video. As always, guys, thanks for watching. Like the video if you want to see more videos like this. Subscribe if you're new here and want to see more awesome Yu-Gi-Oh! Content. And if you want to catch my live streams when they happen, link is in the description to my Twitch page. If you want to go and follow that, get notified when the live streams go live, as well as if you want to join the channel's private Discord server to chat with me and other like-minded people about Yu-Gi-Oh!, get notified in advance when the streams are happening and stuff like that, then the Discord link in the description of this video is something that you would probably be interested in. But other than that, I don't know how to really take this. I really want to test some more with Fluffals against Sky Striker. The matchup, at least in sided games, seems to be a lot more favorable than I originally thought it would be. Just if you draw Kaijus, which means that Kaijus should probably be a more heavy focus in the side deck. But regardless, that's it for this video, as I've already said. Thanks for watching. Thanks for your time as usual, guys, and take care. I'll see you in the next video.